to show a bit of work to have them here.
Yeah.
So there's a
more, everything together.
I took some garments and two, three shoes.
Yeah.
So
to also show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I took one painting of Casper and
okay.
Yeah, one of those flexi boxes.
Yeah.
But I thought the pictures of Max there a bit on the screen, they will be okay.
It's fine.
Yeah. So boxes. Maybe we have to fold them once again.
Should I bring one down already?
Yeah, I think it's well, as you wish.
Yeah.
Or actually, we can go with maybe the three of us together. That's also possible.
Shall I help you too with another box?
Yeah, okay. Early. I'm leaving in a month from here.
Yeah, are you leaving?
I'm going, yeah. I have to leave.
And where are you going?
China.
China?
Yeah.
Permanently?
No, for 6 months.
For so, 6 months?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, you can tell everything about it.
Actually, until now, I don't know much
so,
about it.
And where are you going?
I'm gonna travel a bit first, and then I'm gonna stay 3 months in Shanghai. It's a residency.
And where? Which
program.
One? Which residency?
It's called the Swatch Art Piece Hotel. It's sponsored
by
Swatch.
Oh, yeah, Swatch, yeah, I know.
Oh, you know it?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't. I haven't been there, but I know a lot about
it. I never met anyone who knew it.
No.
Yeah. Easier to make a circle.
I think maybe that's because of those.
That makes sense. Just have a lot of ways. Because the thing,
that table and those things can go to corner.
Yeah.
Yeah. They move
the
other
way by
the side. So then we have more space here.
You think we need it? Because
yes.
I first thought about making a U shape,
yeah,
with the carpets that I could show things in the middle.
Yeah.
Or on, I guess on the floor, but I think with the U shape,
mm-hmm,
if you do it, so one carpet, it's going to be difficult to make everyone fit.
Mm-hmm. And the idea to have a U shape and then put the, these chairs more
to the backwards.
No chairs?
Or no chairs
at all? Yeah, I was afraid that, I mean, some people like to sit, like, more than make sitting on the ground. I don't mind, but
yeah.
Next time?
I think that indeed, if we put all the chairs on top of each other and move them backwards,
mm-hmm.
and
if somebody
there's a very nice space for all the shoes. I think it's also
it's
very nice.
Yeah, okay, that's true, yeah.
So they can put off their shoes over there.
Yeah, okay, let's move the chairs.
And so let's move the longer. Hey, Ben, no,
I can't wait. But soon, I'll be off. Always welcome.
Thank you.
Possibilities, or like this,
yeah.
Or a square. And then, because we do it like this.
From an hour or one and a half hours ago. So you will see the results when we were at Alexis' studio. So guys, thanks also for documenting this evening. We had some fruits.
I think we bought too much.
Well, maybe you get hungry, so please take if you want more.
Like
and
in the concert, maybe like.
And when we prepared, we asked Alexis for a nice image and for the design. And I was thinking, like, probably he will come with. A design of one of his carpets that you're sitting on, or something of his collection. But he came with this image, and it is an image that shows at least that, as for Alexis, fashion is not just about fashion. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, that's of course a cliché, because fashion isn't that limited at all, and it's part of the arts, or the arts are part of fashion, I don't know. At least you don't reckon that much with all these kinds of disciplinary labels. You work and in a certain field, and as an artist, you work a lot together with other artists. That is one of the questions that we wanted to address this evening. Because of his practice, the questions like how to collaborate and how to do that, and what kind of situations does it produce, and that will be different for everybody, and how to deal with it too. And also, the run of this evening, I would be curious for, it is a series about research methods. And these are big words, research and methods, but somehow, indeed, you might already develop a procedure or a way of working or a kind of attitude in which you develop your work. But, I would like to invite you, thank you very much for coming this evening, and to invite you to, start, and anybody can... at a certain moment when you think, yes, I would like to ask something, or maybe you have a comment or something to add, or your own story maybe, or an experience, you're very welcome to do so. But let's first listen and look to what Alexis has to say and show. Yes, please.
Sorry. Yeah, sorry as well. Could have been... a bit not dangerous, but it's always easier with the socks and the carpets. Even though they're stepping on it for 2 days, when they make it, they step on them. But they're bare feet, so I thought it's maybe also better for them not to have shoes. Welcome. You can have a chair. I think there are chairs in the back. Or
maybe I'll just sit in here as well.
But you won't see the screen.
Oh, okay.
Oh, you don't have to. So, welcome. As Eric explained, I
I don't know if you said so, but I just finished last June from the academy here. I was studying with my colleagues in the fashion department. And before my master, I took a year off. I was dying being at school, especially in fashion. I mean, it's hard everywhere, but in fashion, they're very willing to push us to certain limits. So I got fed up and I thought it's time to go away. And so I did. I thought I would like to travel and to have different experience out of fashion design. The very first thing I did was to go to Wuppertal in Germany. There is a dance company which is called Tanztheater Pinabausch. And I was with them for a month. So it's between an internship and nothing, there was nothing official, I had no papers, but I was just allowed to sit in the audience for a month, so doing nothing but taking notes or just watching them. And it was honestly a really good experience because they performed four pieces in 1 week, no, sorry, in 1 month. So I could see a lot, and all the rehearsal. And the work of Pinabausch has been an inspiration for a very long time. I mean, very long, 3 years. It's not that long, but in some parts it is. I just have one picture of her, because I could show for 2 hours about her, but it's maybe fine with one if you know her work already, otherwise you can have a look. Okay, I will just explain why I was so interested in going there and what I learned. Pinabausch has a very different way of working with her dancers. Usually when someone is like a choreographer, when he's starting a piece, he says, okay, you can do this movement, or you can do this, or you can do that, or look for this. But she turned it upside down and she started by asking questions to the people. So she would say, how would you reach the moon? Or what does spring mean to you? Or what are you afraid of? And each of the dancers would go home or in the corner and they would try something and they would come back to her and say, hey, I found something, can you film it? And so each of the dancers would propose an answer which would be as honest and as intimate as possible. And she would orchestrate her piece from these fragments. So from these fragments of individuals, she would build up another piece. So there, it has something interesting also because it touches a certain approach of a documentary somehow. Because you take something that exists already, you put it through a different medium or connect it to other pieces, and it takes another sense in the group. And so I thought, maybe I have to start like this as well, but without asking about movement or questions, I could try to work from different places in the world. So I had 1 year in front of me, I thought, okay, let's go to Nepal, this or another. But I went to Nepal, but the ticket was cheaper to go to India first, so we went to India first. And so this research started a bit there. That's the sign language. I've been advised that I did some sign language. I took some notes. It's a very beautiful one, you should watch it once. It's from Elsa Fitzgerald, The Man I Love. And it's a guy standing like this, and he does the sound in sign language. It's very beautiful. Anyway, okay, this is in India. I was trying to look for weaving. I don't know why, I had always quite a connection with heavy things in wool, and felting and weaving. So I thought that's maybe a nice place to go to. I visited some carpets factory. That's a nice one there. So they're stocking all the wools. It's filled, and it smells quite strong. And you can see here are benches. So when they take a break, they go and lie on things of wools. They just put it as mattresses. Carpet factories. And I was trying to learn about it, just to understand it better, to do something a bit more from the inside. That's where I slept. It was one night in India where I managed to convince the guy of the factory that I could sleep in there. So he arranged a bed with a carpet so I could sleep in one of them.
I went through libraries. There was a really nice one in New Delhi with tons of small samples, like one like this. So I think it's a hill with a little cloud. I'm not sure. And that's a guy I met in Nepal a little bit after. I was trekking around Pokhara, and I went across this guy who was wearing this blanket. So they weave in themselves, and they wear it as rain capes, so they can work in the monsoon season, because it's waterproof. So they put it. Yeah, such a nice landscape. No? And here we see one of the women, one of the weavers. And that's just a snapshot from a film, from a movie. I thought it made sense. No more memory or imagination with graphics, with graphs, new designs. Yeah, because if you think about it, since weaving started, it started like ages ago, I don't even know. But people used to do it from their memory, from their own mind, from their own souvenir and traditions. And now they can print it. So they just follow the drawing and they know where to go and they know what to do, what thread to put where. And you kind of lose a certain interpretation of each individual. So if you take away the pattern, they kind of have to reinterpret it or do something more of their own. Yeah, that's in Kathmandu, I think. I'm just showing this because then there is a guy carrying a very heavy thing. So I thought, yeah, maybe that comes from here. They're carrying a lot of things everywhere. And now I can start with the project itself. Actually, I think it's okay.
Really?
Yeah, because it's here as well. Actually, so, how to do it? Okay, let's. It has a title. It's called Stairs, Zebra, Bees, and Light Purple Jackets. It's four different groups out of one village. This is a map of the village. We have, so the stairs, it's gonna be really hard to see. The stairs, the zebra, the bees, and the light purple jackets. Yeah, it's upside down. I think it's nice if I show it here. Because it's not, yeah. Okay, just for a second. Okay, yeah. So I gave them this drawing, which you see there. It's made by Casper Bosmans, a Belgian painter, and it was one of the ones I collaborated for the collection. I'll explain more about it. And so he made this drawing explaining about the construction of the village. And so the funny thing is to see how they interpreted it. Because, yeah, as an example, the bee, so this is a bee, and this is a drop of honey that falls from the bee. But Casper made a very small line, straight and horizontal and vertical, to construct the bee drop. And I thought, hey, there is a line there. So we'll make it quite visible. So it became something else. And the light purple jacket is actually the other way around. They reversed it, I don't know why. But you see there is a jacket and a trouser. Can you see? So a jacket and a trouser. And the circle became a square because they said the square is too difficult to weave, we'll just make a square. And so I received this, I was very happy. And 2 weeks ago I received this one from another village. It's still not arrived in Belgium, but it's in Kathmandu. Sorry. It's funny because it's from another village, very far away from there. And the woman made everything, like all the single lines. She wove everything, and she made a real circle. The bee is really well made. And that's a group of people from Kathmandu, some of the one that wove the carpet. And so we started with this. I'll give you back. Sorry. Um, I just forgot one important thing. The idea behind the village, or the fact of bringing four different groups together, is a bit a metaphor of our own systems of cultures. Trying to say, okay, if we put four groups of people that are existing in one single place, what happens, or what do they interfere with each other, or how do they influence each other? And so I thought, okay, the collection will be the central part where all these different pieces interfere. And so each of the groups come from a real story with the job of fiction to include it. But the first one is the zebra one. Okay, so the zebra story. I was in Italy, near Como. There are lots of factories for textiles. And luckily, I was knocking at the door of factories. Hey, I need sponsorships for my collection. Can you help me? Can you weave things? It works, actually. Do it like this. And I was crossing a village. It's called San Fermo della Battaglia, near Como. And I saw an old man by the evening, 6 o'clock, wearing a suit. But the suit had stripes, but only diagonal. So the whole suit was completely diagonal. I was like, I keep on going, and I see a second one. Damn, where does it come from? And I barely don't speak Italian, but I went to him. I said, mi dispiace, blah, blah, blah. Where is your suit from? And he was like, oh, man, yes. Some 30 years ago, there was a man starting a tailor shop in that little town. And since the very first day, he decided to cut only stripes fabric and only in bias, which means a 45-degree angle in the fabric. And so since then, there are lots of men in the village wearing suits in diagonal. It's very beautiful. But Casper Bosmans made a small legend, a small painting, to explain about how you cut a piece of fabric in bias. What we see here is the 45-degree angle. How you, with the scissors for a tailor, how do you cut a piece of stripe at 45 degree? And this is how a piece of fabric falls when you hold it from one corner. So it drapes. They used to cut in this like haute couture dress, so very glamour things in the 20s, because it comes very close to the body, so it's like sexy dresses and gala things. But this tailor made it for men. They were not particularly sexy suits, maybe, but they were falling nicely. I sent these drawings, paintings, to a factory in Italy, and they wove this. So it's an interpretation of one of the drawings, where we can see all the things. And I cut in a suit in it. Like this. So what we tried to do is that, so the suit is constructed like a normal suit, but just to leave one of the panels on the left falling. So because when you cut a piece of bias, before stitching it, you have to hang it. So for 2 or 3 days, you cut it in bias, and you hang it against the wall, and it goes longer and longer, because it leaves a bit. So the funny thing is that we didn't hang this one before cutting it, and now it's becoming longer and longer from the jacket. So it's been, 3-4 months, and it's getting really long. And on the trouser, we can just see the other things that became almost logos. These are two pictures. There was a coat made out of this. This is our just two sleeves, and the full coat is one panel without seams. Then we have the light purple jackets. So the light purple jacket group is from England. It's another story, but. Yeah, you can take it this way. But, yeah. Oops. Sorry, the light purple jacket group is almost documentary, but it's a really weird homage that they do in England. There is one family, they're called Perkins. And in 1856, it's okay, it takes 3 minutes, but I have to explain the story, it's important. In 1856, there were lots of British soldiers in India because of the Raj. So India was occupied by English soldiers, and there was a huge epidemic of malaria. So they had to find a medicine urgently in England, and one of the guys called Perkins, William Henry Perkins, was trying to find a medicine in his attic. He was 25 years old, and suddenly, instead of finding a medicine, he invented the purple dye. There was not the ID, but it made him extremely rich, because it was the first synthetic color in the world. Before, everything was made out of these. In Italy, they're coquillage. In English, I don't know.
Seashells.
Thank you. And it was an really expensive color, because they had to press them to find them. It was one of the most expensive color in the world at that time. And after this, when he invented this, it became a huge trend, because not this queen, but I think it's Queen Elizabeth, no. Or another one before, at that time, the queen at the time, wear a dress of that color for her wedding. So it became a huge trend in all England, and the guy became extremely rich. But what's important in this is that it's from that day, they were able to reproduce infinitely one single color without changing it every time. So it was the beginning of an industrialization of fabric dyeing somehow. So to represent this, I took colonial suits from that time, it's from 1850, and I made it four times, exactly identically the same. So it's a white cashmere, and there are four complete suits. And they're sprayed. So James, a friend of mine, came home for him. Well, he had a mask, but I think we both took quite a lot of spraying our nose. But with a car spray, we sprayed him literally. So he had his pockets in his hands or so on. And it's sprayed with pure pigments, so sometimes it stays on your fingers. Here we see it a little bit, but as you saw it, this is James, my courageous friend. And this is, I don't know if you see it, yeah, it's this is a picture of Max Pinkers. So Max is the second artist we collaborated with. Is from Brussels. He's doing a work of photography which is based between reality and fiction. And he has quite a documentary approach also in his work. So we went to Nepal together. I had to pick up some blankets, and I thought, oh, since we paid the tickets, maybe we can go together and take some pictures. And he accepted, so it was good. We went together and another friend. And there we made some installations. So this is to show them the machine they have in England to spray themselves. So this family of the guy William Perkins, that's the story after the round. They decided to, as an homage to their grandfather, to spray themselves with a fresh layer of purple every first Monday of the month. And here is the machine. So it's a machine where you can turn, like it turns like it's a thing like this. And this is a bomb spray. Here you have the liquid gas, and the purple dye goes on you if you turn on yourself. And next to it is a drawing by Casper. Casper Osvald. I brought you the box. It explains about how is the fabric made. It's actually a very special fabric.
You can have a look. Try not to put your fingers on it because it stays with the fingerprints. Try to just take it by under if it's possible. You can pass it. It's nice to see it from close because it's very detailed and it's very beautiful what he does. But so to come back to it. It explains about the fabric process, the working process for this fabric. It is brushed. There are only two companies in the world still doing this today. They use what they call a cardo in Italian, chardon in French. In English, I have no idea. And they still use this today. Usually, it's replaced by metal. And so, yeah, this is in the factory. It's also in Como. It's called Lanificio Colombo. And they're the biggest producer of cashmere worldwide, and also like one of the highest quality. And so they put these on metallic thing, and they brush the fabric from left to right. You see the fabric that rolls like this, and they brush it wet. And so it gives a certain S wave that becomes very shiny. So we have this very luxurious coat. I don't know, it's been a trend like 2 years ago, but it was very reflective for the light. And so we use this fabric, and when you brush it, you have a special depth with it. But so this is what illustrates. We have the fabric that rolls down, the little cardo, and the wet acid. Dum, 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 dum. This is Giuseppe. Giuseppe is another friend of mine. He's Italian. Well, we don't know each other so well yet, but I met him in the town of the Sartoria Zebra, so the one that goes diagonal. And he came to me 2 months before the show, actually. And he was like, Alexi, I have a problem. I'm getting married to a woman from the stairs group on the other side of the village. I need a new suit. Can you help me? But the thing is that he can wear only stripes. So he came with a pinstripe suit. The pinstripe suit is something like this. And he said, can we do something? So we actually cut it, his pinstripe suits, in diagonal lines, and we reversed one side and another. So it built up stairs again. You can't even imagine, so much work. Never again. I think here you see, it's really annoying, because when you stitch in bias, the fabric gets distracted. It stretches. Yeah, it stretches, thank you. So it's really hard both to connect all the white lines and to keep it. Thank you. The clue is for the one who needs to stitch and bias. Now, I got this now. You put a little piece of tape, you know, like the masking tape? And like the most thin one, the 5 millimeters, a shiper, and you put it on the side. So it's just enough that the stitching machine goes next to it, and it doesn't stretch the fabric, and it's really easy to take off afterwards. I thought, damn, if I knew this before. And so, the family was really happy because they thought, wow, what a cool suit. And we had, but the legends woven in Holland, in a factory. This is his original family, the zebra family, and this is his new family, the stairs one. It's the symbol of it. I'll come to it later.
Those symbols or invented ones?
We gave it to them. No, we invented them, and more in the way that they represent something which is particular to them. And now I'm coming to the Stairs family, because he got married to one of her. So I met them in Nepal. They're really nice people, they're lovely. And here we see them, they're around one of the carpets. It's a teacher with the students. And if you would look really well, it's one of the carpets with the stairs. Here is another one, which is older, and you also see the staircases. And so, when I went to the village, I said, why do you make stairs everywhere? Because they literally wove stairs in everything they would have. all the fabric, the houses, the t-shirts, anything. So I said, why do you do staircases? And he said, yeah, there is a legend about 100 years ago, or 200, we don't know, of someone who's been walking through the village uphill, and he was carrying above his head a huge staircase. And we thought it was so beautiful that we made our symbol out of this picture or this image, and we represented it everywhere. So I used it also for the collection. I made a drawing of it, and I asked a friend, Gautier, Ausoden, is the third and last artist I collaborated with, to make a staircase. So it's wood staircase? Oh no, sorry, populier. I don't know in English, but peuplier en français. And so he made this staircase, which are all foldable. So each of the steps have a charnier behind it. So you can do what you want with it, unless you wear it on, you carry it on the other side, so the charnier are straight. Yeah, anyway. This is also with Max. We made a nice staircase and a huge pile of sand. We spotted it from the other side of the mountain. We were taking some pictures above there, and we took a picture with the iPhone. We showed it to the taxi driver. You can take a taxi very cheaply there, so it's practical. We showed it to him, and we said, we want to go there. And we looked for it for an hour, I think. But it's 4 meters high, and we just sculpted stairs in it. And here are more the garment translations. So I started from the blankets. Like this. So you can imagine you're sitting on them. like that. And I had a carpet seller on the show. Because I thought I had too many carpets. Maybe someone should show them. So there was a guy who went on a catwalk with the carpets on his shoulder, and he was putting it on the stage to show them to the people. But we didn't sell any, unfortunately. So it didn't work. They also make houses like this, so we made another one like that. That's a video. That's a video of the weaver. I'll show you this one. What you're sitting on, it's made from four different stripes. So it's wool, it's sheep wool. They're from three different villages in Nepal, and it's their own sheep. So they take it away, they spin it themselves, both white and black. They have to run after the black sheep, of course, because they're fewer. So there's only one carpet black, I don't know where it is, but lucky you. Concretely, it's woven in four stripes. Then each of the stripes is woven independently. So like you see like this, each of the stripes. And when the woman makes it, she sits on the ground and she makes it tight from her waist, like this, to something strong against the wall. She has a back stripe with something in leather, so it tights it up, it pulls it. But because of this, the size of the weave has exactly the same size as the woman's waist. So you have four times the woman's waist in one blanket. But if she's a little wider, you have sometimes three stripes. Or and we made so an illustration of this here with Casper. To show it and to explain it, so we made a portrait of the woman with the size of her waist that fits to one panel. The second thing is that we see a pair of feet because when it's all stitched together, they put it in the water, they soak it, and they step on it, like we used to make wine, for 2 days. So it's a really annoying process. But so the woman weaves it, and the man felts it. So the wool is felting, as I said before, so it becomes waterproof, and they can use it during monsoon season. Here's the coat we see. I thought we should make a coat, which is actually its own description. So this is the panel woven by a woman. We see the portrait again. And if you look carefully, we have here the 2 feet. The 2 feet with the water under. So it takes a special sense when you actually, where the garment is carrying its own description somehow. So it becomes almost a documentary piece. It's like almost as if I didn't choose anything. I just decided to put a description of the process on itself. So I just connected things. I didn't design them somehow. So the shape still is very simple. It's just straight sleeves, as simple as it can be, and yeah, as less decisions as possible, even though you always take them. Yeah, black sheep version, really rare. For this price, you have a student discount if you want. No. And here we see 2 days of work, 1 foot and the other one. The back as well. That's in Kathmandu. We made a poster, we printed it 100 times with the picture of the family, so the portrait woman, the feet and everything. And we asked a monk to make our propaganda. So he went around the city with glue, tapestry glue, and he glued things on the wall. So to give it a bit of a political angle as well. And in Kathmandu you have these, you have tourist shops, when they do ACDC t-shirts, Bob Marley, anything you want. And I gave them, or we gave them the drawing, and they made a series with them. And it's funny to see how differently they interpreted it as well. So we had 10 made, and they're all completely different. Some have yellow feet, or... that's this. The last thing I'm going to show, well, it's the last group, I didn't use it, it's the group of the bees. So they died on the way. this is a picture to illustrate it. It's a story in France on the 19th century. There was a tradition where a beekeeper, when he would die, his family would cover the beehive with a black veil, so to put the bees in mourning of their owner. So we found a beekeeper in Nepal, we asked him to lend us some bee plates, and we covered it with a black veil and flash inside it. And in Italy, there's a company who printed on a, so it's a synthetic organza, I don't know if you can see it, maybe in front of some white. But it's this legend, it's the last one by Casper. It explains about how you cover fabric with beeswax to make it waterproof again. So you take the honeybee, you warm it up, and then it becomes waterproof. So we printed this on the fabric, and it was supposed to be a silhouette, but time run off, but it's not so clear, but it's a nice blue. I think this is, I'm showing this at last because I think it's a bit of a synthesis of the project. When I was in New Delhi, I was on the market, and I met a woman, she was about 50 years old. And she had in front of her, she was selling fabric pieces that she embroidered herself. But in these fabric pieces, she actually depicted her own daily life. It was a little bit like a diary. They were very beautiful. I mean, they still are, I think. But so, oops, it's hard to see maybe from a distance. But it's a portrait of people, like the kitchen table, the water pump, the woman picking up mangoes in trees, or like this. I think here's the mango one. I'll pass them through. Yeah, have a look. Check, 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 check. Okay, one. Okay, here. Three and four. And I found it so beautiful that they actually depicted their own life, like in such a diary way, that when I came back to Belgium, I thought I should make something with it. And so I decided to tell the story of my own village somehow, of these four different groups. And so I thought I will ask them to make embroideries that tells the stories that could happen in my village. But I thought, they don't speak English at all. So I had a friend there who was helping me with them. But I should write it in Hindi. So I went to the market on a Saturday morning on Theaterplein. And I found someone who could speak Hindi. I told him all my stories, 11 different stories. And he said, okay, I'm going to write them down. And so they're all the different scenarios taking place in the village. I scanned it. I sent it to the son of the woman that printed it. He gave it to her, and she split it in three villages and 11 different women that could make embroideries for 2 months on it. Just crazy long. And they're here. I can show you just a few that are a selection, but yeah, I think they're nice. I didn't use them in the collection. This is a wedding of Giuseppe, my Italian friend. So it's a wedding between the stairs family and the zebra family. So in India, it has a very strong signification, wedding. So you have the groom, no, the bride and the groom, thank you, which are in the middle, and each of their respective families are or above or under. So if you look, I'll show it to you later. These are all diagonal lines on their garment, and I asked them through the scenario to do the other family with staircase embroidered on the garments. But the funny thing is that in Hindi, staircase and ladder is the same word. So they made ladders everywhere. So yeah, it's a nice one. They have just ladders on trousers and on the t-shirts. That's also where it became beautiful to me and almost more real. And it's also where it became a collaboration, because they took part in the process. It was their own perception of the story. It was their own eye on what is a stair, or is someone carrying a staircase above his head? No, it's a ladder, he's going on. Or, so, here we have, that's a spraying one. So I told them, yeah, there are some people in the village, they're spraying each other. And so in front of their houses, there is one holding like a spray bomb, and the other one being sprayed. Let's see if we can. Almost the last one. I found this nice. It's relating to the bee story, so the death of the beekeeper. I told them, yes, there is a beekeeper who died in the village, so his family covered it with a black veil. So the bees covered the bees with a black veil. And so what happened is that they put it, the beekeeper lying on the table, burning, because it's how they do it for Hindu people, usually. And you have the people around and all the bees, which they make black, to be significated that they are covered. Sorry. It becomes very graphical, so, somehow. And the very last one, which I found a nice one, I told them, this is all for my jury presentation. So at the end of the year, I'll be presenting it to my teacher. Can you make a portrait of myself? With my models behind me and my teachers in front. And so I'm in the middle, and there are six people behind, one carrying a ladder, and my two teachers sitting on chairs on this side. Like this. Enough about this one, it's just a nice one to show. I asked him to make an autoportrait. So you can see 11 women working on each of their pieces of fabric, and they're making embroideries of little ladders again on the squares. You can, if you want. I had all of this. I thought, it's a lot of things from different countries, but I need shoes. It was very late in the year, so I thought, what about having something very local? So I wrote on Google, I wrote Belgian shoes. And I found out it's a brand who's based in Ezegem, for the one who knows. And it's one of the two factories remaining in Belgium, still making shoes there. And I wrote them a mail, and I think I went to knock at the door, it works. And they sponsored the project, and they made some Belgian shoes for me. I brought you two of them. This is them. This is all the pairs they made. He's from Poland, he's the one who glued everything and polished the sides. She's Els, she stitched mainly everything. And this is Georges, her wife and her daughter, and they're the three people owning the company. Well, he's the boss, but the good thing about him is that he goes in his office, he does his phone calls, his mails, and he puts back his white jacket, and he comes back and he glues things. And then he polished them and he glued things again. And it's very nice to see a boss taking part to the full process, or I think that he's not the boss, but just somehow collaborators as well of his own team. I'll just pass four samples of them. We made, if you remember, the two bare feet in the water. It's woven and it's an incrustation in the leather. This is a white one with it, and a woman portrait on the back. This is a woven one, leather. It's very chic, but it was a nice contrast with the coat themselves. If you want to shoot. And the last one, the guy forgot to take off the tassels. A tassel is the one, you know, that you fold on themselves, you roll them up. It's a bit like a trend thing, and they float in front of your shoes, I guess. Yeah. So this is how it looks like if you don't roll it. And it stayed in between the two layers. We printed the sizing on the shoe, and we didn't cut the lining off, because it was easier to take them in your feet. That's it. If you want to look at a piece of the woven thing, and they're really nice on the back, if you want to turn them, because you can see all the threads going. Yeah, that's it. I don't know if...
Did you start the company with kind of shoes, colors you want to make, or textile, or...
Excuse me? No?
Did you instruct the company itself? What colors to use, what materials you would prefer?
Yeah, ideally it was always nice to take part to it, so to stay with them for some days, if possible. I always gave them like a starting point, let's say, or an image to start with. But in most of the case, I always try to give them an half of the interpretation march. But it worked mainly in Nepal and India, because they're mainly hand-woven things. And in companies, it was quite difficult for them. Most of them refused to take this freedom or this responsibility of putting their own creativity and their own eyes into what they were doing. But most of the time we tried to take the product for what it was, describe it, analyze it, and start from this. So it had always this documentary approach, but...
So if you would prefer, you would go the same way with the shoes as well?
Yeah, I tried. I think it didn't work as much as we wanted, but we really started from what it was, and we didn't try to change it completely. We took the normal shape. We just made a bigger sole under. It was a bit less feminine, somehow. Less thin, I guess. But if I could, I would, I think. Yeah.
Can you tell a little bit more about this very documentary approach?
Mm.
So how does it work? You say a little bit already about it, but so it's about leaving something, you don't really want to change it, but at the same time you come with your own story,
mm-hmm.
or a motive.
Mm-hmm.
Can you maybe explain a little bit more? Is it a certain procedure, or is it an attitude?
I think it's an attitude. I think I learned this from Kasper on the beginning of the year, because every time he would make the drawing and he would go to Nepal and he would come back and it was like, oh look, it's different. And it was like, wow, yeah, of course, because it's so much nicer. And I think I learned also to accept that people would give their own personality in their own things, and that actually was where all the beauty was. So I think it started with this, that I would, it started with accepting somehow, because you start with the mindset of saying, okay, I would like this in this color, and then they give you something different. And to be honest, the project didn't start like this, it started more like, let's see what can happen. And seeing the difference showed a bit the potential of it as well, of collaborating with people and of having shared parts, like 50-50 in the process. When I'm talking about documentary, it's also that I don't try to transform the product into something else. I try to stay very close from the shape, the color, the material, or the way it's meant to be. So this documentary approach is also how you try to take a product for itself and not trying to adapt it to a westernized version of it, or not trying to conform it with your own expectations.
Maybe I was mistaken, but with some of the works, you say, yes, actually, this is what I really liked. This is even more how you,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. how it fitted with this idea of this approach. And so, for instance, the last small
squares
that you showed.
Yeah.
So there is, it doesn't mean that if you accept what happens, that it is always what you, in the end, would like most. Or is it also about leaving the whole attitude of judging?
I think that's more about this. I kind of realized, but that, like, that I was, I think we are, but that I was very judgmental concerning qualities, material, or design, or visual expressions, and there is a kind of it's more trying to go into a respectful approach or respectful way of working. Like we see that I don't know, I'm taking it like easy example, but in Bangladesh, people are producing things, but we have no clue of what's going on in the country. We don't know anything about the culture, about the people, their geography, the attitude, or the financial situation. So I found it interesting and also actually essential in some ways to get to know what we are working with, or to get to know who we are working with, and to see actually that they are even maybe more creative than we are, and in their own ways. And it was, I was trying to see how people wouldn't be just makers. So if I would work with a producer, he would be, I would try not to see him as a producer, but as a collaborator, which means that he would have the influence. Yeah, I'm repeating, but yeah.
Did you feel that your work was more about documenting the whole process? Like,
mm-hmm.
as you said, like the process from Pina Bausch, when
mm-hmm.
she asks everybody to do their own interpretation of something,
mm-hmm.
and then puts it together in a choreography. Do you
mm-hmm.
feel in that way more like a documenter, or
mm-hmm.
did you also feel like you interpreted it again in your own
mm-hmm.
way? Like when you received all these things and
mm-hmm.
you made something with it, was it purely to show their work or your work as well?
Even if you want to take yourself completely out, I think it's just impossible.
Mm-hmm.
Because you keep on watching it, and just by watching it, you change it. I mean, because you're an actor as well, you're taking part even if you don't want to. I always tried, I think since the very first year at the Academy, just to connect things, to do things for a reason somehow. So not starting from an aesthetical point of view, but more from something that carries its own characteristic, or that carries its own values, or I wish I could take my things myself completely away of it, and being just someone that connects pieces, and because I think that's what we do already as people with each other somehow. And I think there is so much potential in this that we don't need to give opinions. I mean, it's a kind of an aesthetical dictature already.
You think this idea that you have, which is now, that it also maybe is a reaction on like your 3 years or 4 years of training in the academy?
Yeah, definitely. In being at the academy, but also being, I'm all in Belgium or Europe, or it's definitely a reaction onto something. If I can put images on my words, just I'll very quickly show you two things, because it comes back to this, and I think it could be interesting to show it now. Good question. Yeah, sorry for the mess. Yeah, so this, oh wait, sorry, I didn't show you this. This is James. Yeah, something in there. And I think I had, oh yeah, here she's weaving. See how the wood is so well organized behind. And it's really impressive. The corners of their house, they're sharp, straight. They're really good craftsmen and they're really skilled. And everything is really organized. They have no money, but it's so clean and so well made. It's 10 hours of jeep to get there, but it's worth it to go every day back and forth. Oh yeah, this is the stairs sculptures. Yeah, it was really important to put some dry sand on top of the wet one, because then you think it's made here since a while already. Sorry? It was a good question. I don't know. It was in a chantier, in English, a working place, like.
Construction
site. Thank you. I think they're doing cement with it. But we asked for the authorization, and they didn't give it. But we waited a bit, and they didn't say anything in the end. But they, when you explain them that you want to make stairs in it, of course it's. It's different. I went back to this, but I wanted to show you very quickly a project I did first year at the academy. We have to make three pieces: a dress, and then a jacket. And the jacket, we had to make it in felt. And we had to make a jacket with felt and paper. Without knowing really very much why, I thought, okay, maybe let's go back to the origin of the product already. And so for the paper, I said, okay, well, I'll take the shape of the tree because it's just where it comes from. And for the felt, I'll use a very gray one, very rough, very hairy. And this picture is taken in Linkeroever on the other side. And I looked for a tree that would be quite accessible, and I took a mold of it. So for 3 days I felted the wool around the shape of the tree with water and soap with the hands. And so it took all the small details of the trees, all the small reliefs and everything. It was really like a mold. I let it dry, and then I took it off the tree by cutting it into pieces. I was taping them so you could know what fits with what. It was a bit of a puzzle, but. And then I reconstructed it, and I suspended it in the air. Like this. So it became like a kind of empty memory or empty shape of the tree. And I think that carries somehow the same values of just putting, same values, I don't know, but the same idea of putting two things together and letting them interact by their own property or shapes. Like I didn't decide how the jacket would look, because then he put an arm in a branch and it would fall a certain way and that would be as it would be. I don't know if I had a picture of the guy wearing the. No, I don't think so. Oh, maybe. Sorry. Oh, yes. Ah, no. That's Peter's jacket. It's a nice one, though, if you want to see. There is a violin, it's made in paper. That's also his first year jacket. And this is Henrik, a guy in her class. Okay, maybe not. No. Okay. Then the second and last thing I wanted to show, but I don't have any. Oh yes, here.
Whoops.
No. Sorry. Sorry. It finished like this. So it was very abstract, of course. But we didn't choose then. Oh, well, we did, because we draped it for, I think, 16 hours in total, in 3 days, to find in what way it would be nice to wear it. And we documented it all in pictures. I'm stupid, I had it here. But, yeah. How we could wear it. Anyway.
So that was some kind of initial, well, maybe your procedure or your recipe, this making use of this tree which is already there.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So you don't actually have to invent a new form or a piece. You use what is
there. Yeah.
There.
Yeah.
But you have to.
But at the
cut
same
it out
time.
And
at the same time, I remember biking. For more than 10 hours, I did all the woods in Linkeroever, all the woods in Stadsbeek, to choose one or to have one. So that's already a choice. I had to choose the tree, and so I think I also take it for some aesthetical reason, not only practical, because I could have taken a tree which was at my height, like so I could just work like this. That was 3 meters high. So it's always. Double. You don't take a decision, but of course you do one anyway. I just connected to one thing when you said, is this a reaction to what you did at the academy? Are you at the academy?
Yes.
Yeah? Sorry. I've been away a bit. In first year, we have to do a attendance book, which is like something, like a whole process of designing a collection, but not making it. So going through the whole process of research, but you don't have to stitch anything. You have to give all the info without making it at the end. And I remember from the very first year, I got fed up with the idea that it had to be so visual. I remember thinking that, damn, on the catwalk, you don't do a silhouette to be worn, but it has to be so visually powerful that it becomes only a visual effect. Nobody cares if it's nice to fill in or to be on your back. Nobody ever cares about this. And if you do, you're out. I mean, they don't give any value to this. So I thought I was a bit tired of using my eyes so much for the design process, and I thought I should close them for some time. So I closed them for 100 hours, 3 days and a half. And it was pretty intense and pretty hard. It was a really hard experience, actually. But it ended up well. So people had to bring me food. My girlfriend came with a sandwich and the morning tea and everything. I remember eating my tea bag because I thought it was a piece of bread. But all the things like this. But I just have the book here. It's impossible to have it on the screen and to pass it over, but this is a picture of Alessia Pradolini. She used to study in photography, and she used to paint in her pictures. So this is a picture of me, blindfolded, looking for my walls. That's gonna be tricky. But we do not have to look at it. Where would be the important part? Maybe this. So during the 100 hours, I would take notes of everything. I would bike in the tunnel from Linkeroever to Antwerp, blindfolded, and Hilde was telling me left and right, left and right. It's a good experience. Do it if you can. You're freaking out, but if you, it's a really good exercise to trust the people you live with, because then you're like, okay, should I? Because you give yourself completely to them, somehow. Because if she says left, and you go left, and there is a wall. I mean, it's always tricky. Yeah. when I was blind, I made, I'm looking for one thing. I made a new map of my space. That's not important. A second. This is called entoptics. It's an effect that you have if you press in your eyes and just a little bit, you close them and you press on them slightly, you see shapes appearing, and it's because your nerves are sending informations, so they're like abstract visual shapes. And sometimes you see words, or maybe I was getting crazy because of the blindness, but I started to draw all the single shapes that I would see passing through. For 1 minute per page, and these would become prints on garments, or colors, or trying to paint. Maybe like this. This one. I was painting on the wall by choosing the colors randomly. So just put the brush in something that looks like a pot of paint and you draw something. And I was also trying to draw these entoptic shapes, but in bigger scale. And the last thing I can show you also, it had to do with perception. And it's somewhere here. this one. So I thought if I would, because when people are blind, they it's really weird, but you become so sensitive to everything, the sounds, the space, like the touch, and your brain starts to build up a space only from the sounds information. And they show that actually it comes from the way the space resonates back to your ear, so you're able to draw it mentally. That's weird. And also, they showed, like, some scientific studies showed that if you stay in a completely pitch dark room for more than a week, you actually start to see things appearing. Not being crazy, but your brain starts to really need visual aspects, visual things. So it can't grab anything, so it starts making things. And so I started also by drawing my own body, but the way I would perceive it from one hand. So not a real one, but a more perceptive one. I would sit on a big plate of paper, and one hand would go around, so my outlines, I don't know, and the other hand would draw it on the paper, on the ground. And that was the base for pattern making. So I wouldn't make patterns for my own body, but for my perceived. Some research, blah blah blah. It turned out to be like this. But still, it was very aesthetical. It's crazy, but I really don't like the overview of this, because it's like killing the whole experience. You're building up something which is all about sensation and feelings, and you're 2 days before the pass, and you're like, shit, I have to draw. And then you do something and it comes back completely flat. Again, you lose all the feeling, all the perceptions, and it's just a projection of yourself into something that could be. So, yeah, it's also always a bit frustrating to do all this research and to have to translate them into a certain medium, which is here extremely strict because it's something you wear on yourself. So it's also why, for me, it's important to keep on exploring things around. Not to have this restriction. Sorry, I don't know if you had other questions.
I wanted to know, like, how it started, like, for your master collection. You were telling about, like, four stories, like the purple jackets, the bees, and everything. How did you stumble upon these stories? Like,
Something that you collect is... Do you know Hans? Hans Tess? I guess most of you met him or heard about him in classes or whatever. He explained me once about the story of the Bororos. It's a story that wrote, it's a study that made Claude Lévi-Strauss, an ethnologue, about how do people keep peace in their village by having symbols. So, I can't draw on anything. But if you have a village, mostly it's like, okay, ideally it's built around the river. So the river ideally goes from north to south, and you build a village around it. And then, so that's one axe. And you have the second axe, which is from east to west, let's say. So you have a division in four groups, and each of them have their own specific identities. I'm from northwest, I'm from south, east, blah, blah, blah. And the study shows that each of these groups actually chose a symbol significantly around their own stories or their own particularities. And they showed that there is one rule that keeps the peace in the village, is that if a guy from the zebra marries a woman from the stairs, he has to go and live with his mom, so in the house of his mom. That's in La Pensée Sauvage, the white house. I don't know the English title. But it's this theory where they keep the peace by having this rule that when you marry someone, you have to go and live on the other side. So it, on a few generations... Sorry. My cold is coming back. Sorry. On a few generations, it grows that you have relatives in the whole village, in the four different parts. So you're never really going to fight with the others. And they realized that building symbols was actually their way to keep a balance between their own identities and the respect with the others. So it started with this theory of having a village divided in four and to see how they would relate with each other. And then the rest is just collage, just a structure and an excuse to put it in place.
This might just be my observation, but it sounds like in a lot of the projects you're kind of working around the areas or the things where fashion fails, in a sense. Whether it's about representing things that can be represented, or like aspects of the body that can be represented, or about the kind of commercial aspect where we're making stuff really quickly with cheap resources and
mm-hmm.
kind of not putting any personality in it.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a conscious decision? Is it not a conscious decision? How do you feel like this fits into the context, the great context of fashion as well? And where do you see taking it as well in the future? That's kind
mm-hmm, of as Eric said, I think it's an attitude. I think it's crucial in our world nowadays. To be conscious of what are the consequences of the things we do, if we decide to draw something, or if we decide to produce 100,000 shirts in China, what does it mean to them, to their economy, to their way of living, to their social, I don't know, everything. I think it's extremely important, and it's becoming more and more important to be, conscious of this, or at least curious of it. And I'm taking it into a creative way, but also because it's what I do, or what I try to do. So, I don't know, it's just an excuse maybe to go there and see how it works. I'm not sure I answered your question.
No. Like I said, it was more of a kind of conclusion I made in my head. It wasn't.
Okay.
That's the
okay. I have a cat too. But it's a nice one because they do it in Kathmandu as well, in the same shop. They really made an effort for me because they normally they don't do it on caps. I asked them, the guys with the t-shirt, to make a cap for me. And they made the 2 feet. I think it's brilliant. So when I'm home, I'm working, and I put my cap on, and I'm the filter. So I'm the one who goes and steps in.
Yeah, you said a couple of minutes ago about this the story of not seeing and then trying really to have this experience of trusting others who will guide you,
mm-hmm.
or trusting your own, well, drawing your own body, but in a different way. And so, in fact, that research, because you made a kind of laboratory also,
mm-hmm.
of your own situation,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
then that research you valued a lot, and still you do. But the problem was there at that moment in translating it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so you, in that at that moment, you made a kind of collection that didn't translate the research.
Yeah.
And so it is also about this translation of a research,
mm-hmm.
in a certain way that
mm-hmm.
would that the essence of it and that still shows or
mm-hmm.
that communicates.
Mm-hmm.
And I think already from your story and who you are and what you show, it was really clear that when you ended up with this line of just people wearing all kinds of fashionable clothes,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
was something different than the experience
mm-hmm.
of the research. But in what way, so you, in a certain way you developed a way to better translate this kind of experience.
Yeah. I think because being blind is really just a mental or physical state as well, but it is not directly connected to garments or to cultures or to aesthetical expressions. So when I thought, okay, I'm gonna try to make a master collection, maybe it helps if I address directly to the cultures themselves and the garments themselves or the fabric themselves. So it was easier somehow to show the process, like this experimental process at the end, because the end would be the process itself, or the explanation of the process. So like the portrait of the woman and the feet and everything, by taking it already in, or from where it's from, or from, let's say, a garment, it's much easier to translate it back into something that it is, or how, well, I'm...
because there are even, you could say that the images that Casper contributed,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
they are some kind of extra direct
mm-hmm.
explanations, kind of like a cartoon of the essence of the story or the essence of the way of working.
Mm-hmm.
And so it shows it. There is a direct bond with where it came from,
mm-hmm.
and you didn't do really complicated things to translate it.
Mm-hmm.
It's really there.
Mm. But so it's a kind of just a process of going to this tourist shop and saying, "Can you do this for me?" and to take it as a final piece. But it's but it's funny because somehow also it becomes abstract again. I'm sure none of you would be able to understand what it means. I mean. Not even myself, especially not myself, if I don't know what's the story behind. So you can actually explain everything you want, as long as you don't put words on it. It loses its sense, so it loses its... it loses its sense. I mean,
the woman that is making this life of tissue, is like tradition from where she comes from, or is it something that she came up with?
This woman? Yeah. Is it?
I'm writing a paper right now about naive art. And that's really what it is, right?
I think so, yeah. I guess so.
Not,
I guess you know
not,
more.
It's not a tradition, or it's something that she came up with? Like,
So I think it's something that originally they didn't tell it to me, but I think it comes from there. I saw in a museum, a textile museum in New Delhi, that people were making warm clothes for the winter, like 2,000 years ago, by putting many, many layers with each other, and they would assemble them by making little stitches to bind them together. And also because you pull thread, so the fabric shrinks a bit, and it gives a little bit of a relief. It's very beautiful. But I think now it became aesthetical, because it's just one flat layer. And they actually made a copyright deposit for the technique in that specific village, and it's called Sujuni. And they have the authorization to do it, but only there, so they copyrighted it. So I don't know if we can call it a tradition. I think it's more an interpretation of one of the practices they had. And the fact that they show their daily life is particular to this place. I think so. Someone wants a clementine? We still have apples.
Okay, can you say that documentation is more important for you than the path itself?
For who? For me or for the people I'm showing my stories to?
For you, for yourself.
The research, of course. It's because, for me, it's actually the only reason why I'm doing it. If I collaborate, it's because it's essential to me to connect with people. If it can be through work, it's great. And it's essential to me to get to know things to get to learn every day through the things I do. And collaborating with people is a great way to see things from a different perspective. So in a way, I always do my works by thinking, okay, what could I learn, or where could I go? And for me, the final thing is in a way, is okay. If it doesn't become something, that's not important. Yeah.
Is the medium of fashion and garments, is it still important to you, or do you feel like your next project could be like translated into an installation that has nothing to do with it?
Yeah, I'm doubting. And I'm scared. Because I'm scared. I mean, it's been 7 years that I've been studying garments. And sometimes it's becoming quite heavy, because you always have to put it somewhere. And I'm afraid that if I'm waiting too long somehow, I won't be able to get off of it or get out or push it off at some point, because I know I will need and I will want to get rid of it at some point, but I don't know when. So now I'm doubting, is it a good idea to really keep on doing this as a regular practice, or interfering it with more visual arts or with things? I don't know, it feels tricky. Now I'm going for the next project. I'm going to China for 6 months. I'm doubting, should I make something with textiles, which is addressing to garment, or textiles which is addressing to visual art, or nothing in textile? And yeah, I don't know. I'm sorry. I wish I would know, but I don't.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. If there are no other remarks.
That's a good question.
And, Alexis, thank you very much. I won't add anything. over China and especially also in Shanghai and going to this residency.
I'll
we
need it.
To hear from you and we will follow you. And thanks for all these kinds of stories, words, explanations and all your work all over the place. And thank you all for your presence. I have one additional announcement, but it is also a question. There is, for those who would like to finish their paper in January, so for those who already were working on this research methodologies in the arts and would like to finish it in January, there is a moment organized for consult or for advice. And that can be in 2 weeks, so when there is the next Academy guest evening, but we can do that in the afternoon of that day, the 15th of December, or the day after, because then I will also be in Antwerp. So that would be the 16th, and that is then on a Wednesday. I wanted to ask, are there people who would like to have this moment? So then you can come with your questions like, I want to do this, I have this already, and now shall I go for this direction? Maybe it's too much, should I focus on this or that? And we do that with the group, so with those who would like to have this advice.
So is it possible to have it on Wednesday?
Well, that was my question. If I say it is Tuesday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and you all have lectures or you are not there, then it would be a pity. Well, you maybe can be there on Wednesday. So are there people who would like to have this moment that day? You?
Yeah.
And another one? Okay. And would it be good to do it on Tuesday in the afternoon or the day after around lunchtime?
For me, it's Wednesday.
For you, Wednesday.
Yeah.
He's looking. Wednesday? Wednesday? Okay.
No, Wednesday.
Yeah, okay. You have my mail address.
Yeah.
Please send me a mail in the upcoming 2-3 days.
Okay.
And then we arrange a time and a place to contact. Next week, not next week, so in 2 weeks, the 15th of December, Gluklia Natalia Peshina Yakimanskaya will be here. And she is from St. Petersburg. Since 2 years, she lives in Amsterdam. She also wanted to have her daughter coming here, who is 16, because she can't stand Russia anymore for living there. She was really active in a group called Shkod Yelat, What to Do. And What to Do was constructed, they created it at the moment when Putin came into power. And it's a group of authors, artists, philosophers, politicians. They come together and work on projects to have a consciousness through culture and art of the political and economic situations in Russia. But she does this in a very humorous, active, dynamic, but also really careful and honest way. And she does this through research, a lot of interviews with people in Russia, but also in Western countries. And she works with theater and theater costumes a lot. She talks with costumes. She makes costumes that are plants that grow and that grow in a certain way that it stands for how you can move, how you can be autonomous. And it's a very fascinating person. And so you're also very welcome that evening. So that is in 2 weeks. Okay.
I just have one very last question. Does anyone speak Chinese? Because No, if any of you has a drop of time, some like I don't know, at some point, I need to learn just a tiny bit before leaving. It's maybe longer than just a tiny bit that it needs to be learned, I guess. But if any one of you is willing to give some lesson or something, I'm willing to to learn and to pay for it. So if you give classes of Chinese, I mean, take it.
Thank you.